we get Griffin out of the way?
We're in the shop.
Oh.
You still got your shroom on there from one of the other episodes.
Don't ask my wife about my bucket list because that's a touchy subject. Welcome to the ADHD Dan podcast.
It goes where it goes.
Ty Ayers.
That's right. I'm here.
Not tires.
It can be.
Yes, it could be.
You know, it's funny. I grew up and nobody ever called me that until I moved here. And the first person I met, they're like, oh, tires. I'm like, whoa, maybe. Where I'm from, it was Ayers. My name is Ty Ayers.
Where are you from?
Well, Harrisburg. It's not even that far away. But okay. We moved up here where my family's originally from, and everybody knows it's Ayers here. But down there, everybody said Ayers. Mm-hmm. So I think nobody made the connection.
So when did you move, like, to the Altoona area?
15.
Or wait, no, you moved to Martinsburg.
Is where we moved to, yeah.
And how did you connect with the people in Altoona?
Music, really. I moved up here, and it was really weird because we moved, it was like 4 or 5 days after school let out. So I had all summer by myself, and, you know, like, I didn't know anybody. And that's when I really picked up guitar and started playing, and I started a band there in high school at Martinsburg, but then immediately started playing with Adam Pillmeyer and stuff, and that's how the Hope Fallacy came together, was just knowing them.
Dang, I forgot about Hope Fallacy.
Yeah. It's a whole legacy.
Because I was thinking more about, because Pat wasn't in that, was he?
No. Nobody from the Cove area. They were all,
I mean,
Altoona.
Lang.
No. We were Dropout High.
Yeah.
Okay, so 704 Stellar was a band with Pat Ritchie.
Mm-hmm.
Pat Ritchie, I wanted to write a little bit different music. He kind of wanted to say, I mean, it all ended up being pop punk and being the same thing. So,
right.
But, so we got Pat Lang, and he said, we shouldn't keep the same band name, keep it new. Let's name it Dropout High. So it was me, Pat, and a guy named Brian. And we played for a little bit, recorded an EP with Slim Studios, Adam Cruz. I don't know. And when it came time to paying for it, nobody wanted to pay for it. So I sold my PA system and some guitars and everything just to be able to pay for the EP. And everybody just quit. Like, there's one copy of that, and it's sat on my desk since we got it. And but then I run into Jeremy Jock, who was in Dropout High Like a Movie, and he's like, hey, we're playing with you. And this is when I had started, when Adam and I had started the Hope Fallacy. And I was like, oh, cool, what band? He's like, Dropout High. I'm like, oh, no, we broke up. I'm in a new band. He's like, well, no, I'm in Dropout High. I'm like, well, that's my band name. Like, what do you mean you're in Dropout High? And he's like, well, yeah, me and Pat and Jimmy. I'm like, wait a minute, that's my band name.
It
made me mad, but
yeah,
we were all friends, so you can't be too angry. But then they got Andy and everything was...
Because Pat was in a band... I feel like Pat just needs to be on here just because he's been in every band just about. But Pat was in a band with me and Mike Greenwood.
Yeah.
And he talked about at that point changing the name to Dropout High, like our band name.
Right.
We were like, we change our band name so many times. Nobody has any idea who we are. I don't want to change it again.
Right.
And then shortly after that, he left and must have been like, right around
in
that
time. Okay.
Wow.
Yeah, it was weird. It was funny.
Yeah. So what then from there, like musically, have you lived in this area since, or did you move away for a while?
I went to Cumberland, Maryland for like 6 months, but I never changed my address. Like, I was still here.
Mm-hmm.
So, I've been here ever since. From there was the Hope Fallacy, and I stayed there until Hello Vixen. And that one is where everything just kind of took off for me. So it was weird. Like, I, you know, the Hope Fallacy, everything I had done was original music, and that's all I ever wanted to do. And I'm sure you understand this, but I was broke. Like, mm-hmm. 21, 22 years old, and like, the only thing I had was debt.
Well, when did you start having kids? Because then that just compiles the debt.
I didn't until I was 27.
Okay.
So my wife had a son who was 2 when I met her. He's 14 now, but I didn't have any until I was 27, a little more.
Mm-hmm.
I can't even say established in life because I wasn't until even after that.
Are we ever even established in life? No.
No. But I remember I got the call to join Hello Vixen playing bass, and I hate playing bass guitar. I feel like I'm not good enough. Like, you need to really have the perfect rhythm, and you need to have everything good. And I just felt like I didn't have it. I felt like I wasn't good enough to be on bass. But yeah, Hello Vixen asked me to do it, and I'm like, no, I don't do covers. Not a chance. No way, no way, no way. Well, they call me again that night. Will you fill in until we find somebody? Sure, I'll do that. So this is like a Tuesday or Wednesday night, and they email me 40 songs, and it's like, we play Friday. Good luck. You know. Luckily, they were all, you know, Taking Back Sunday and Blink and stuff that we grew up on and knew, but I didn't know how to play them. I at least knew the songs, though. And I remember it was the night before. I'm like, hey, this email, some of these are in bold and underlined and stuff. He's like, oh, yeah, those are the ones you're singing. I'm like, oh, awesome.
So not so only you learn this.
So not only am I learning, like, because I did end up playing bass in the Hope Fallacy, the second Hope Fallacy. Because
I remember you playing bass. It must have been Hello Vixen that I remember. Because was that like 2009, 10, 11, somewhere in there?
10, 11, yeah.
Okay.
9 would have still been.
Because I was Jared and Mike at that time.
Right. Yeah, 2009 would have been them. And I remember Friday night we go to the Rathskeller in State College and play a show. And Mark hands me an envelope after the show. And I'm like, all right, thanks, man. Thought he got me like a card or something. I just threw it in my truck and left. And then the next night we're at 4D's in Altoona. And he hands me another envelope. And like, I'm opening these, and there's $250 in each of them. And I'm like, man, you didn't have to pay me for helping you guys out. That, you know. And he's like, well, no, that's what we make every night. And I'm like, oh, yeah, I'm in a cover band now. Like, this is what I do. And that's what I did for a few years. Like, didn't work, didn't do anything, just played cover music, and it was awesome.
Yeah.
So.
Did you take the songs, like, you were already doing, you said, like, Blink, Taking Back Sunday. Mm-hmm. Kind of pop punk.
Right.
Did you take any top 40 stuff and like try to punk that up? Because that's did like with Jared a little bit, and that was fun. It was
here and there. I mean, I two a night maybe, you know, but mostly it was all just the older stuff, the nostalgia, nostalgic songs that made everybody. Because I think what worked so well for us was, you would see so many times, especially when we play somewhere new in front of new people, they'd be like, oh, I haven't heard this song in so long. Like, everybody remembered them, but no other cover band was playing them. Nobody else was doing it. So it was cool.
Actually, I just heard Corey Muro.
Yes.
I didn't realize he's in like a kind of a pop punk karaoke band.
The emo band.
That's it. Yeah. I think I saw things on social media, but I didn't know anything about it.
He's a busy man.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's doing Punchline, the emo band. Lakeside? I can't remember the country band name.
Or Lakeview?
That might be it. But he's doing that, and then he's drumming on people's tracks and stuff. Like, he's busy. Yeah. I'm happy for him.
I asked him, it wasn't this past Christmas, but the Christmas before, if he would record drums for I Won't Be Home for Christmas.
Oh, okay.
So he sent that, and then I was like, well, I have him, so who else could I get on this? I got Jimmy to sing. I got my friend Wade to sing at the end, but it was cool. It was like doing one of those remote collaborations.
Right. That's not easy.
No.
The band I'm in now, that's how the entire EP happened, and it was terrible. It was really bad.
I think the hardest part of that would be, like, you'd lay down drums first.
Sure.
And then kind of, okay, send that off.
Right.
But what if down the line you're like, oh, I would like to adjust that. Do you have much play?
So this whole band came out of quarantine, so we knew it was going to be difficult. We knew it was going to be just something different than we've ever done. And basically what I would do is I would write a song, I would drum it, guitars, bass, vocals, everything, and I would send it to Steve. And then Steve would take it and drum it and then send me the drum tracks. And I wouldn't listen to anything but just those drum tracks. Completely forget what I wrote before. And then I would write to those drums. It was challenging at times. You know, because there's, you know, you're like, well, I really wanted this to drop out here. But he kept it going. Or, you know, vice versa. And it made the songs cool, though. Like, it was neat. Yeah.
That would be an interesting dynamic to try.
We never got in the same room together. Except for the very last day or two, and it was just a mix together and get all the mastering done and everything. It was a trip. It was fun.
So now, do you all have the capability to record at home, or how did
you? Yeah, him and I both have a studio.
Okay, good.
So, and it was just him and I. Mm-hmm. We didn't even have a band. We had shows booked and we weren't even a band yet. So
it was just like fill in the spots. Like,
yeah.
How did you go about finding people?
It never happened. So we had, the whole plan was September 3rd was the release date of the EP. And in July and August, I think we had shows. And they were like the Railroaders Museum, like the bigger shows in town. And I'm nervous because I'm like, we're 2 or 3 weeks out. And I ended up picking up a box and got an inguinal hernia. So I was out for 8 weeks. So now I have 11 weeks left until the EP is already announced that we're releasing, and still only have 3 songs recorded. I need to record 3 more, and I'm down, like down. And
yeah,
I was in surgery and I couldn't walk for like 2.5 weeks. So it became challenging, but it worked. So,
who joined with the band then?
So, Joe Scott. And Ty Miller are who ended up playing with us. Ty Miller was from Central. He played in a band called Doubtfire with me for a few months right after Vixen. He's from Pittsburgh now.
Okay.
He lives there now. He was in Young Lungs. I don't know if you remember them.
That sounds familiar too.
Okay. And Joe Scott was with Pistol Peg, the country band that Steve was in.
Mm.
It was weird. We all left pop punk and did country for a little bit. And I'll tell you, I hated playing country music, but those shows were awesome.
Yeah, people really get
like,
into that.
Yeah, well, they were awesome and it paid so well. Like, the money was good.
Yeah,
so
lots of hungover day afters.
Yeah plenty of those.
Yeah, I'm sure.
I think the biggest thing was like the girls come out to see the country, so the guys come out to see the girls, and the crowds just doubled immediately.
Yeah.
You know,
one guy I used to work with said he would go to Chippendales like performances.
Oh, okay.
And I was like, why are you going there? And he's like, all these girls.
The girls.
It's like, see, you're smart.
I brought you a present. Is now a good time?
Sure. Hold on. Let me do this first because, yes. So, yeah, we got Ty Ayres. Ayres, however you want to go with
wherever
that.
Wherever you're from.
So this is what I did. So I wanted to use the CD. I originally wanted an autograph with it, but...
That's awesome.
Yeah, so I did that, just threw some stickers and date and stuff, so...
That is so cool.
For sure. And this, it's been like such a crazy week. That was all done this morning.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, yeah. I mean...
Where, I can't believe you still have that CD.
I don't even know where I got it.
What, 2000?
Maybe from Pat.
One.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So that CD's old enough to drink.
Right.
Damn.
That's cool. Oh. I didn't feel old until you said that.
I don't like thinking about that.
You made mine this morning. I made yours yesterday, but I made you some koozies.
Yeah. Oh, dude, these are awesome.
And every pop punk kid needs their own pins.
Oh.
So.
I'm going to put one on my jacket.
There
I just got
go.
A Pennsylvania pin.
There you go. With and New Jersey.
A little bit of Jersey. I don't understand that. Oh, hell yeah.
But thanks, those are keychains. And those are pins. So funny story about not noticing things or about not paying attention. When you play shows or before you're on stage, do you just hit that zone before you get on there and just completely lose everything and just completely blank to everything around you, or not really?
I feel like my nerves are so through the roof.
Right.
And it's like, it's not necessarily like being nervous. It's more right. of like
focus.
Yeah. And kind of a little bit of anxiety. Like, yeah. Okay, I'm just ready to do this. Like, you have right. all of that energy built up and you're just ready to let right. it go.
Well, I have this life lesson that I learned like 2 years ago, and it was to not do that. And and there's a good reason. So I was playing a show with Jimmy Mowry, okay? And I was at the Diamond in Hollidaysburg.
Oh, and I can throw some B-roll over this because yeah. I still have all that footage.
Right. So, funny story. This guy comes up to me and he's just talking and talking and talking, like, hey man, do you need help carrying gear? Do you need anything? Like, come on. I'm just like, man, just leave me alone. And I felt bad. I just wanted to be left alone because, you know, mm-hmm. I don't look people in the eyes. I don't do anything. Like, I'm focused on what I'm doing. Like, keep in mind, we learned those songs that morning.
That was very last minute.
Right. And,
but you did a really good job.
Thank you.
Like, all of you.
It really worked out well. Mm-hmm. Like, all things considered. But yeah, this guy like just kept talking and talking and everything. And, you know, the show's done. And I talked to Jimmy the next day and he's like, yo, Dan McNulty took a bunch of awesome pictures. And I'm like, that's the guy. I talked to you for like 20 minutes and I had no idea who you were.
Oh, because so you like just blew me off.
Yeah. And I feel really, really bad about that because I had no idea.
I don't even remember because so my backstory for that show, I went to... He was at Permane's the night before.
Sure.
So I shot that. I stayed at my friend Steve's in Lakemont and then woke up early and drove to State College to help a friend shoot a wedding.
Okay.
And then straight from State College back right. to Hollidaysburg.
Right.
So I was out. I changed in my car when I got to Hollidaysburg. Right. So
it's so funny because I felt terrible. You know, and he said about you taking these pictures. I'm like, that was the guy with the camera.
Yeah, that was that guy.
I wish I would have talked to him and said hello. Because, I mean, it had been 10 years since I've seen you, give or take.
Yeah, I was trying to think other than that show when the last time.
I mean, probably when we played together at Faith. Probably. Yeah, I felt really bad about it. And now I like make a very conscious effort if somebody comes up to talk to me.
All just because of me.
Yeah. At least just look them in the eyes and see who they are. Everything tastes better when it's in your own koozie, doesn't it?
Would you like a koozie?
I'm good.
Kind of few I could lend you if you would like.
We can do a story about the songs.
Yeah, go ahead.
If you want. Like I said, the songs were written apart from everybody. So right. I would get these drum tracks from Steve off of a demo that I wrote, and then I had to rewrite everything. And we wanted like a spacey sounding, not copy Angels and Airwaves, but do that without...
I kind of felt it in the delay.
Right.
Like when the guitar would kick in, it was like, ooh, it feels good.
Right. So you either say, if you're our age, oh, they're doing Angels and Airwaves, or if you're 10 years older, like, oh, they're doing U2. Yeah, you know what I mean? It's one or the other. Mm-hmm. But Tom will straight up say, like, yeah, I took this off of U2, you know?
Yeah. So who would the younger kids say it sounds like?
Nothing. I don't know. Everything's so hip-hop right now.
Yeah.
Or, like, pop, I guess.
Yeah.
We tried to get a lot of different sounds in there. I sold all of my amps, got rid of everything, and went straight modeling. So
many people are doing that.
Yeah, but it's so nice. Like, yeah. I carry a little box this big, plug into a show, and I'm ready to play. I like the sound of the Kempers, but there's not a lot of effects inside of them. Like, I wanted, like, kind of an all-in-one.
Is there, like, an effects loop in it? Or would you just run effects to it and then...
Either way.
Okay.
So there's a touch screen on it, and this is kind of where everything came from. I would have a delay, and like, well, let's see what it sounds like after the amp. So you just click and drag. And mm-hmm. well, what about a reverb going into the delay? Or now the delay into the reverb? Or what if we have, you know, we split the channel
yeah.
and there's a left and right and this one's doing a quarter note and this one's doing a dotted eighth.
Yeah.
And now all of a sudden you have one guitar and it sounds massive. Yeah. You know, like you're running an orange in this one and a Mesa in that one. You yeah. know, and it's just so... to me, it's appealing because you can
yeah.
you can get any sound you want, any...
Like, you're not limited.
Right.
And that you're only limited by your own mind.
Right. And I think the reason I went that way the most was, you know, I would do a country band, and then I would do a rock band, and then on Sundays, I'd do church.
Yeah.
So it's like, I need three rigs, three everything. It's like, just get a box.
Right.
You know, and you're
right.
done.
So much but, lighter, too.
Oh, yeah. I kind of got sucked into synthesizers and just figuring everything out. And there would be days. My kids go to school. My wife works. I just sit at home for 8 hours a day just going over one sound that's just wah, 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 wah. And mm-hmm. now, but now I want it to go wah, 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 wah. Like, and just figure everything out. And
mm-hmm.
you never know what you're going to come up with.
Yeah.
And, but the EP we did with Paper Plants, I guess it was all by ourselves, and we were doing September 3rd is the release date, and September 1st we're finishing it up. And
this was this past year?
Yeah, just this okay. a few months ago. And it needs to be submitted to Spotify, Apple Music, everything within like 3 hours. Well, I get up to Steve's house, and the last song on the track, Trials and Tribulations, just isn't there. Because we had been not emailing, but sending stuff back and forth through Studio One. Well, every track that we had, you know, you clip off all the ends. Every single track was moved to the beginning. Mm. So you had like 3 seconds of just boom, and then like a drum track, or then a random guitar like wah, wah, wah.
Yeah.
So we had like 2 hours left, and we re-recorded that song entirely, all but the drums, because we were at Steve's house. He already had all the drums saved. Mm-hmm. So like we jumped on there and just threw it down quick, and yeah. I'm sure it would have came out a lot different if we had the
wow.
time. But it was so stressful. But mm-hmm. you know, we had already canceled 2 shows because I couldn't walk. The last thing I wanted to do was cancel a release. Mm-hmm. So we just did it. We
yeah.
sent it out, and it worked.
Yeah. As far as messing with synths,
mm-hmm.
I've never used a synth, but I okay. feel like I love to loop things
right.
and mess with effects before and after. And
yeah.
Yeah. That's just, it's just such a unique.
Yeah. It's so much fun.
Yeah.
And then you put an entire synth through a pedal board.
Yeah.
And now you've got a whole different
mm-hmm.
sound, a whole different world. Like, I love it. But yeah, with Paper Plants, getting back to that, like I wanted to write just something different than what I had ever done before, because it was very, I just felt like I was doing everything so repetitive, and I thought, you know, this is, I'm getting older, I'm 35, like this is kind of my last chance
mm-hmm.
to do anything worthwhile, so I wanted to take my time and do it.
That's kind of a depressing way to look at it, though.
But I'm all about staying young forever, but there's times you got to pay the bills, and
yeah.
you know what I mean?
Uh-huh. Yeah.
But no, I don't know, a lot of little hidden things in there just that nobody's picked out yet. And I always kind of wanted someone to hit me up with it and be like, I see why you did that.
Mm-hmm.
And it hasn't happened yet, but I'm sure eventually.
Yeah.
Maybe if somebody sees this, they'll be like, I got to listen now.
So. Uh-huh. Yeah.
You know, when we first started getting ready to play live, it had been like 3 months since I heard any of these songs. I was so tired of them by the time we were done recording and getting everything done that I didn't listen to them. So I it was kind of like doing covers, just learning something that you wrote. It was weird.
We're floating here, staring at our thinner eyes, and I see daylight on the horizon. We should not be allowed alone by ourselves. The city lights, they barely show up here. The thought lives on where we grew up, yeah. We should not be allowed alone by ourselves. When we try to fly away, we get stuck in our ways. Stay the course of yesterday. You and I alone, we can't fight gravity. I feel the weight pulling me in quickly. The view up here is worth the wait, yeah. We should not be allowed alone by ourselves. Shooting like stars roll around in the ether. Crossing signals, getting stuck in a force hell. We should not be allowed alone by ourselves. Try to fly away, we get stuck in our ways. Stay the course of yesterday. Cause you and I alone, we can't fight gravity. When the world starts to wake, stay up through the haze. Made it through another day. You and I alone, we can't fight. Fly away, we get stuck in our ways. Stay the course of yesterday. You and I alone, we can't fight gravity. When the world starts to wake, stay up through the haze. And made it through another day. You and I alone, we can't fight gravity. No.
My lid on that one.
I'm just sliding off.
Yeah. I was saying to my wife, I'm like, oh man, he asked me to play acoustic, and I've never played these songs without a delay pedal before.
That was the first one that I listened to.
Oh, okay.
I think that was the first one, like the featured in iTunes or something. Good stuff.
Thanks, man.
Do you still play at a church?
Yeah.
What do you...
With Jeremiah.
Really?
Yeah.
Man, I'd like to see him.
I started with him like 3 years ago. So I didn't for 10. But then... Because he started a new church.
Right.
And when he was doing that, he just hit me up and was like, hey, I need a guitarist. And again, I was like, no, I don't want to do that. Mm-hmm. And then I called him like 2 weeks later. I'm like, all right, I'll do it.
Yeah.
And I've been there ever since. So it's been like, what, 3.5 years? Something like that.
Hmm.
So
there's something about, I feel, playing in a worship band that it's like, I don't know, it's just like a powerful feeling.
It is. It is. It's made me a much better musician for sure.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you show up Sunday morning because he sends everything out like Tuesday night for us to have Sunday. But I'm normally listening to it on the drive there, and I'll look up the chords quick. I'm like, oh, what is a C major sharp 9/13? I'm like, I'll just play the root note.
Yeah. Yeah. What is this?
Just figure it out as you go. Music. Yeah. Yeah.
Who would you say, as far as like big bands growing up, were some of your biggest influences?
Not big bands.
Or like radio big, or...
I guess you could say Blink. But I tried really hard not to get into that. I loved the underdogs, like the guys that the band that really pushed me to start playing was, I remember, because I mean everybody knew Blink, everybody was down with pop punk and stuff, and I said, I want a band that sounds like pop punk but they have harmonies like the Beach Boys. And somebody, and a friend of mine was like, check this album out. It was Major Motion Picture from Punchline. That was life changing for me. Like, that album just did it all. And like, honestly, like, that's all I listened to for like 2 years. Like, that was it. And bands that they would play with, or, you know, have a show with or whatever. Like, it was so weird because, like, that was my goal. Like, I just wanted to, like, see them live or play. Like, it wasn't even, like, a play with them. Like, I just wanted to see those guys play live. And then I found out they were just from Pittsburgh. And I'm like, oh, they're not even far from here. And the first time I saw them live, we opened for them. And it was just, like, really surreal for me because I viewed these guys as, like, mega stars, you know. And they're like, oh, man, we're just from down the road, you know. And that was so weird for me. And, like, I never got into the mainstream thing. Like, and I'm not saying that because I'm like, any reason. It's just like I liked those other ones more. I think like the less polished style. But I guess like if I had to pick a mainstream, it would be Blink. But
Tom or Matt?
Matt.
This is over. This is over. Let's turn this all off.
Listen, I'm a huge Tom fan. Huge. I love Angels and Airwaves. I love everything he ever did. Matt brought something to him. He really did.
Have you seen them live with Matt?
Twice.
I haven't. I just...
Yeah.
I feel like they should have changed the name.
I don't know. I mean, I agree with you. But they didn't change it when they got Travis. They didn't...
Right. So here's my thing. I think if you... If you're an established band and one of your main vocalists... like decides to leave.
Right.
I feel like it's not really the same band. I mean, that's by a standard that I set in my head. AC/DC, I will say with AC/DC though, they have, it was like a similar sounding voice, but that kind of contradicts my.
Right.
I don't know.
I don't know. I'm a Matt guy. I thought Nine was, no, I'm wrong. Neighborhoods, I would say, is their best album, but Nine is a very close.
Yeah, Neighborhoods was
so good.
I just felt the tension within the band,
and that was beautiful. That, like, you needed that. It brought the grit. You know, like I felt like it was, that was what they were trying to hit when they were doing Untitled or self-titled.
That was probably my favorite musically. Yeah.
It was good, but at the time, like, I wasn't ready for it. You know what I mean? And there's a lot of bands that, like, I'll listen to, like, three songs, I'm like, that's not that good. And I totally skip over it. And then, like, 5 years later, I'm like, whoa.
Yeah.
That was amazing. Like, All Time Low. I was like that with them. Like, I loved everything they did. And then, like, when Last Young Renegade came out, I listened to, like, one song, and I completely just, like, nah, not my thing.
Yeah.
And now that's my favorite from them, except for the newest one. Like, it's weird. Like, I don't know. I think I personally wasn't ready for anyone else to grow up or have a more mature sound.
Yeah.
You know?
So, yeah.
But, yeah.
So, like, speaking of mature sounds,
sure.
Are there any bands that you didn't like what they matured into that you would prefer to see, like, more of their older style? Like, you can be one of those old guys that's like, it's not like it used to be. It'll make albums like they used to.
Never Shout Never. Dude, I'm an emo kid. Like,
yeah.
I thought I loved his stuff in the beginning, but like, I wish he would have separated the two. I don't know if you ever listened to him or them or.
That's one of the bands that I kind of listened to a few tracks here and there and just kind of.
Yeah, I wish he would have, like, kept his name as one and the band as the other, because they were both great, but... Yeah, other than that, no, I don't know. I think now that I'm, like, looking back at it, I kind of like where everybody went. You have to change.
Yeah.
I think, like, there's one band in our scene that stays the same and it works for them is Bayside. Mm-hmm. Like, they, you can listen to last year's album or one from 10 years ago and, like, you know that's them. Mm-hmm. And it works for them. But I don't know. That's a good question.
Yeah.
Like, maybe Paramore.
Okay.
I know, I liked where they were in the beginning. Mm-hmm. A little heavier and less pop. But
yeah. Well, now you have that bitch ripping them off.
Oh, yeah. Olivia Rodrigo.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And yeah. I heard my kids were playing that, and I was like, is that like a Paramore remix? And
right.
Like, what are you talking about? So right, I turned right. it on, and they're like, what?
Yeah.
They stole the song. I said, no.
Right.
Back up
right,
here.
Right, right.
So then I thought about doing a, like, some kind of cover and like
mashup.
Yeah, I was gonna do it because I found isolated tracks for all of them.
Oh, okay.
So I was gonna do it, and then it's like slightly a different key, and I thought it's more work than I.
Oh, is it a different key?
Just
I never listened to
it. I think it's like a half step.
Okay.
One way or the other, and I just
yeah.
When it gets into that, I'm not screwing around.
Right, right, right.
So
yeah, that's a lot of messing to get them together then.
Mm-hmm. So what about locally? So let's mm-hmm. go to musicians who you've played with.
Yeah.
Who have been some of the most influential to you?
Adam Pillmeyer. Actually, like all the guys in the Hope Fallacy. Like, if you ask me one regret in my life, what is it? It's that I left that. That was heartbreaking. Like, I lost everything the day I chose to leave that. And go do covers. Like, the money was good, but I lost four brothers, you know, like mm-hmm. it was tough on me.
Did they break up at that point, or did you just move on?
I just left. Okay. And they I kind of wanted to do covers, like, you know, I knew money was okay there, and I was older than those guys. Adam mm-hmm. and I were the same age, but the other guys were like 3 years younger, so they were focused on leaving high school, college, and I was already past that, you know what
yeah,
I mean? And
yeah.
it was, I wanted to do this, and that's all I wanted to do. And yeah, you know, they all went to college, and they're all doing very well for themselves. Everybody is.
Mm-hmm.
But no, like, just leaving that brotherhood mm-hmm. still hurts.
Yeah.
Honestly, because I don't talk to them the same way.
Yeah.
You know, like, it's just, I don't know. It's just, it's different. But Trey, the drummer from there, like, we just had a connection that I've never really had with anybody else, because it...
Wait, did he play at the Hollidaysburg
yeah.
thing?
Yeah.
I didn't realize that was him.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Hmm.
Okay. Yeah, him and I were... It worked, because I was on bass for that, so, like, we were the rhythm section,
mm-hmm.
and we just had a connection that not... that I haven't really had since.
Mm-hmm.
Steve, that I'm with now, and I was with in Hello Vixen, like... we do, but it's on a different, just like a different plane,
yeah.
you know, but there's something about Trey.
Yeah.
I just loved working with him.
And it's always nice when you have another musician that you just, you can't really explain it, but there's that connection.
Right. Like, I could just look at him and be like, try just going like, and he'd be like, oh, this?
Yeah.
yeah, that, you know. You never knew what, he somehow knew what I meant, but I didn't
yeah.
even know what I meant at
yeah.
the time. yeah, I would say those guys would be the most. Jaggard in Altoona had a lot of people coming through there, like a lot of
yeah.
big bands and a lot of, you know, like you would see somebody on MTV and they'd be like, oh yeah, we played with them like 2 months ago.
Mm-hmm.
What? I don't remember that.
yeah.
But you did. And it was wild. You know, like there were so many bands coming through there that were really on the up and up.
And so and much of that has to be credited to
Ryan? Ryan Wapner.
Yes.
Yeah. He brought everybody in, and he knew how to play the game, man. Like, I mean, because he ended up going and running with Valencia, like, full-time for a while. And then he went with the XX or somebody. Like, there were, like, a few bands that you would see him post, and you're like, what are you doing with them? Oh, I'm running merch with them for this tour.
Yeah, I just heard he's doing some kind of merch distribution.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah. Well, I called him one day, or I texted him and said, hey, man, are you happen... are you going to go to the Dropkick Murphys show in Pittsburgh? He's like, actually, I'm running merch for them. I'm like, awesome. Well, I guess I'll see you there. You know, like, it was just everything. Somehow, like, their merch guy was sick or something. He had to leave. And Ryan, I think this is the story, but he filled in for, like, a night. And then they're like, well, hey, we need somebody for the rest of this tour. And he's like, all right. Mm-hmm. Get me back to Altoona and get my clothes, and then we'll head out.
Who's running, like, everything in Altoona now? Is there any kind of scene?
If there is, I don't know about it. Like, but I don't do social media, really.
Yeah, are we just too old to know if there's a scene or not?
I'm tired of the drama, like, on social media, like, on Facebook and everything. Like, I just try and stay away from it. But I did sign on. Like, I have to for the band. And mm-hmm. you have to sign in through yours to get onto that page. So, of course, you'll see in, like, I'm seeing all my friends, like, dressed up in emo, and I'm like, well, what's that? And evidently there was a huge emo night Saturday night, like, two nights ago. And I'm like, oh, that would have been kind of cool to see, you know, like, to go to and run into all those old people again, or your old friends.
Yeah. Well, yeah, but we're all old people now.
But no, I as far as original music, McGarvey's in Altoona's doing it. Mm-hmm. But they're a 21 and over.
Right.
And, I know 4D's reached out and asked if we would, but as far as, like, a venue, I don't think, like, that's Greensburg and...
No, like, church basements anywhere?
No.
Somebody needs to take up that
Too much liability.
And, yeah.
Too much... Everybody's so sue happy anymore, you know? And...
Well, and COVID doesn't help.
Well, yeah, that too.
Yeah.
You know, I think with everybody being locked inside for a year, changed... Like, I mean... internally changed everybody.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, I don't really want to leave now. Like, I've made my place at home. You know, like, my best friends are my wife and kids. You know, like, I don't need to go out and see anybody anymore. Uh-huh. You know, like, it's weird.
How has becoming a husband and father changed? I don't know. Like, what do you...
Well,
what did it do to you?
I became a dad before I became a husband. And I'll be completely honest, I didn't know what I was doing. I took it really bad. I love my son. I was so excited. But once I got it, like, I didn't know how to handle it. I really didn't. Mm-hmm. I was working at a job I hated. My wife was busy work. She owns her own business. She's at home. But she was way busier than I was and making way more than I make. So she was the breadwinner, and that was hard for me to deal with. And it was just a lot of, I didn't know who I was, and, like, how am I supposed to teach a human who to be if I don't know who I am? And that was hard, because I was right on the brink of, like, the band stopping and starting a new one. And everything, like, my life flipped upside down. Like, I didn't know how to handle it, and I did really bad at it. I handled it really bad. I don't think you're ever ready, though.
No.
Even if I had another one right now, I wouldn't be ready for a third one. You know,
no, that's, like, that's, I feel like I tell people that all the time. Like, people, my friends who have been married for years, and I'll say, oh, are you gonna have kids? Like, I don't usually ask that if it's the right situation.
Right.
I'll bring it up, but it's not like, hey, you need to have kids. You know, that's the next step, because sure, they're getting it from everywhere. But yeah, a lot of people will say, well, I'm not ready for that. It's like, you're never ready.
Right.
Just do it.
Yeah.
Like, for anything.
Yep.
So.
Yeah, it wasn't easy. It's easy now. I love it now. Mm-hmm. I would have 5 more now. Yeah. But at the time, how many do you have?
4.
You have 4?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I don't know.
It's...
Maybe I don't want 4.
It's awesome, though. Like, now, it was... Well, so 3 of them are girls, and my youngest just turned 13 2 days ago.
Your youngest is 13?
My youngest daughter.
Oh, okay.
My youngest is Case. He turned 11 in December.
Oh, wow. Okay.
So, and my oldest will be turning 18 in June.
No way. Wow, man.
Yeah, that's...
That's nuts, yeah.
It's a lot.
Yeah.
But... I think for me, the best and worst part of being a parent is seeing your, and I know I've said this before, but just seeing your good and your bad traits in
your kid. Oh, absolutely.
It's like, it hits hard.
Yeah. That's why we always joked with my wife. I'm like, I just want him to look like me. I want a mini me, but I just want him to have every part of you. Like, I want your intelligence, your everything else. I just want him to look like me, like, but nothing else. And I got that. Like, yeah, I got that. That's cool.
Yeah, like, and as they grow, they'll like develop, and you'll see little things come out here and there, and it's like, damn, that's me, or right? That's Liz. It's, actually, one of my daughters was talking the other day, and I thought it was my wife. It's like,
oh yeah,
man, it just it's all crazy.
It is cool to see. I think that the best part about it is you kind of get to be a kid again.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I mean? Yes. Like, that's the best part of it. And I was so afraid of that. I thought, I have to be an adult. I have to get this kind of job, and I have to make this kind of salary, and I have to this and that and that. And like, I was just beating myself up. Like, I didn't know. That kid just wants you home and hanging out with him. Like, he doesn't care if you're making how much or versus, I mean, as long as you have enough to provide, and, you know, and luckily we're okay. Like, but it was scary at first, like, because I thought I needed to be so much more. You know, I grew up feeling like we had everything we ever wanted, so I wanted to make sure my kids had that too.
Yeah.
But I just felt like I felt inadequate, you know. But turns out we did okay. They're still living. So.
Yeah, that's at the end of the day, that is what matters. It is time for the rapid fire questions. Number one. Yesterday or tomorrow?
Tomorrow.
Number two. True or false? Moon landing.
Oh, false.
Finally. You hear that?
Yeah.
You hear that. Number three, we already kind of got into bass or guitar.
Guitar.
Four. Why are you here today?
Funny story.
Remember, 10 seconds.
10 seconds. New Year's Eve, my wife asked me what my New Year's resolution was, and I said I wanted to be put into a magazine, I wanted to do a podcast, and I wanted to be played on the radio because of the songs I wrote, and you asked me to do it.
There it is.
Yeah. That was like 9.8 seconds, yeah, though.
We'll have to check the official time on that one. and actually, that one was, there wasn't even anything on that card.
Oh, okay.
I just...
So I had 20 seconds to answer that one.
Yeah, maybe. last rapid-fire question. What drives you?
The feeling I... musically or life? Just like my kids and my wife first. What drives me musically is seeing what you've made out of nothing. That might just be the whole thing. Seeing what you've made out of nothing.
Yeah. That's... Yeah. Wife and kids.
Right.
Same thing.
Right.
Hmm.
That's where the... paper plants comes from.
Yeah, I wanted just to ask like, if what yeah. the story was behind the name,
okay.
or if you'd give that.
Sure.
I didn't know if it was top secret.
Like, well, first, it's kind of a play on words in many ways. I'm the only guy in my family, extended family. So my dad, his brothers, all the brothers, my grandmother's brothers, grandparents, all the men worked at the paper plant. And that's how they made their living, was through the paper plants. My wife owns a paper company, and my mom worked at a place that sells plants, a nursery. How about that? So like paper and plants, and then you can, like, with origami and with just woodworking, which is another thing my wife and I love doing. It's just making something out of nothing. And that's where that all came from. It's like, you know, the paper plants fed us all growing up. And now for my kids, paper plants is, you know, buying dad guitars.
That's a lot.
It is. It's deep.
It's a lot. Yeah. Deeper than I was expecting, because it's, people know it.
I've been sitting on that band name for like 5 years. It's just been a long time. And I'm like, you know what? This is the project for that. So
have you considered Dropout High? I hear that's free right now. Legally, I don't know what would happen.
I don't know.
But I don't know.
I was always a half step down guy until I started playing guitar on this hand and keys on this hand, and remembering A instead of, you know, you're playing an, you know, an A on here, but an A flat on there. That was difficult. So I just moved everything back to
So do you speak fluent pianist?
No. I'm pretty good at jokes. But other than that, no. So did you grow up listening to rock and punk rock the whole way through? Like, from little up?
So when I was really young, it was all, here's a radio, here's Way Truth Life Radio.
Okay.
Don't touch this.
Right.
Like, the dial on there.
Yeah, yeah.
So it was one day, I think I was in fourth or fifth grade, I was sitting out behind my house and I was like, what does this do?
Yeah.
Because I've tried everything else on here. So just being the curious kid, I started turning it and Last Dance with Mary Jane came on and I was like, what is this?
Right.
So that was my musical awakening.
No way. Okay.
Yeah. So that was huge. And then that it just spiraled into sixth and seventh grade. I started getting into the Pumpkins. Like, I'm still a big Smashing Pumpkins
fan.
That's
the band that changed everything for me.
Yeah.
Like, I grew up in a very bluegrass and country home. My grandfather was a professional country musician. It's what he did. So that's all I knew. It was just like bluegrass and country. And I remember being on a, I was at my buddy's house and he had a cassette tape and he puts it in, you just,
oh yeah,
do you want to play this?
I don't know it, but you can play it. Oh, it's just Eat
A. That's it. Yeah.
Dang.
We don't even care. Shake these sipper blues. It's all it is.
The only two songs I learned from. That and.
Oh, yeah.
That's like the only two.
Right.
And for someone who inspired me so much musically, I just never learned any of their songs. I just felt like it was another level that.
If you didn't have a tube screamer, you couldn't sound like them. Like, you couldn't play along to them.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, they were different, in my opinion. Like, they just had a sound that you knew was them. Even if they were doing something like Tonight Tonight or 1979 into, you know, Bullet with Butterfly Wings. Like, even like they were so different, but so the same.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's in the production of it or what it is. But.
And I think one of the things that really caught me with them, the first thing was definitely just those guitars.
Yeah.
Just can kind of rip through anything. But then the more I dove into them and their albums, just how they're just able to go from this rock medley in your face to just this soft
symphony,
like, Melancholy and the Infinite Sadness, just piano. How do you do something like that?
Right. Were you allowed to listen to that stuff?
No.
Me either.
I bought Melancholy, the double disc set, and then my parents looked through the word book and they took it.
Dude, me too.
Yeah.
That's so crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, no, because I didn't get it. Mm. My friend had the cassette, it had 1979, Tonight Tonight, and Bullet with Butterfly Wings, I think, were the three on there. It was just like the demo. Remember how they did like a single?
Yeah, singles.
Yeah. And I think those were the three on it. I know 1979 was on it, but my mom listened to Bullet with Butterfly Wings and was like, absolutely not. You are not listening to this.
Mm-hmm.
I'm like, come on. You know.
I think it was Zero that did it for my parents.
Really?
God is Empty.
Okay.
Because they were like,
Do you censor your children?
Yes and no.
Okay.
So I don't care if they're like, if they would walk out and be like, I don't know, if they just say, what the fuck?
Yeah.
I wouldn't really care. I mean, it would catch me like,
yeah,
what is this?
Right.
But I just don't, I look at it differently, I think, than I was raised.
Yeah. I'm the same.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because I think with any kind of censorship, it was just, you had to know what was on the other side. And you were so, you would do anything to get to the other side, you know. But still, you knew right and wrong. I think that's the hardest part of saying, like, this person is saying this because it's artistic expression. Mm-hmm. You know, and like, that's what I try and show my kids. Like, you can sing about anything you want, but it's when you personally act those things out towards somebody.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you want to yell and scream certain words, go ahead.
Right.
But don't yell it at somebody. Mm-hmm. Don't yell it at your parents. Don't yell it at your grandparents or your peers. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so, I just try to let them know, you know, there are certain people that I wouldn't care personally if they said it around, but hey, right, there are going to be repercussions.
Oh, yeah.
If yeah, you say it around this group or, right. And then also, yeah, I think along those lines, I'm very much just, it's about your heart.
Right.
You know, and if you're using it negatively towards someone, then that's right, not a good thing. You know this one?
Passed out on an overpass, Sunday's best in broken glass. The bikes and bars suspended like spirits over speeding cars. You and me were kings over the parkway tonight. On forever while we walk around this town like we own the street. We stay awake for summer like we own the heat. Singing everybody wake up,
everybody wake
everybody,
up,
everybody wake up. It's time to get down. When I pass the bottle back to Pete on the overpass tonight, bet we laugh. I'm gonna stay 18 forever, so we can stay like this forever. And we'll never miss a party, cause we keep them going constantly. And we'll never have to listen to anyone about anything, cause it's all been done and it's all been said. We're the coolest kids and we take what we can get. The hell out of this town, buy some conversation. The low fuel light's been on for days, doesn't mean anything. I got another 500, another 500 miles before we shut this engine down.
Shut it down.
I'm gonna stay 18 forever, so we can stay like this forever. And we'll never miss a party, cause we keep them going constantly. And we'll never have to listen
to anyone about anything, 'cause it's all been done and it's all been said. We're the coolest kids and we take we can get.
You're just jealous 'cause we're young and in love. Your stomach's filled up and you starve for conversation. You're spending all your nights growing old in your bed, and you're tearing up your photos 'cause you wanna forget it's over.
Just jealous 'cause we're young and in love.
So much for having me.
That was it. yes, I thank you for coming out. Thank you for coming out.
Thank you so much for having me. Yeah. I had a blast.
Good seeing you again.
Absolutely.
Thank you to my patrons. Thank you to Anthony Menzia for the intro and outro music. I love you all. Have a wonderful day. Seriously, just
yeah.